I want to welcome everyone to the Legislative Forum 2012, Living Better Longer. Today is an opportunity for us to hear about the health issues directly impacting us here in Marathon County. My name is Joan Toyer, and as health officer for Marathon County, I, along with the health department, am charged with the responsibility of preventing disease, promoting health, and protecting our environment for the 134,000 residents in the communities they live in, learn, work in, and play in. I am grateful that I don't shoulder this responsibility alone, for together, as a community, we share in creating the healthiest county in the state. Growing up on a small dairy farm in the western part of the county, my parents role modeled for me what it took to be successful in life. I saw firsthand the benefits of having a goal, staying focused during tough times, and most importantly, the need to set aside differences to work together with your neighbors, whether it was to build a barn, harvest oats, or help out during illness and death. These are the same ingredients needed for us to succeed to be a healthy community. That is, having a goal, staying focused, and working together to address the health issues facing us. As a child, I took for granted that every child had access to fresh fruits and vegetables out of a garden. The joy and wonder of playing outdoors. I was fortunate that I only heard stories about the impact of alcohol on other families, not mine. I was less fortunate, though, when it came to tobacco, resulting in both my parents dying at a younger age than my grandparents. In 2000, as a nation, we celebrated life expectancy being expanded by 30 years. Within 100 years, 30 years of life being expanded. It's pretty amazing. From 47 years in 1900 to 77. The majority of the years gained in life expectancy were due to public health policy that addressed things like clean water, safer food, vaccines against disease, and recognizing tobacco as a health risk, to name a few. Clearly in 2000, we did not think that in 2012 we would be faced with this fact. And that fact is our children for the first time will have a shorter life expectancy due to chronic disease. The good news is we know what we can do to prevent chronic disease. We know that tobacco, alcohol, and obesity play a significant role in developing chronic disease. We know that public policy to address these health issues can make a difference. Similar to the public health policies that occurred in the 1900s, which added 30 years of life expectancy. This afternoon's forum is about the future direction we will take together in ensuring that children today will be able to live as long as their parents. We do have opportunities and choices about what action to take to prevent the impact of chronic diseases on our children, family members, and our communities. I, like you, want to ensure every child and adult has greater access to locally grown fresh fruits and vegetables, to know the joy of play and being physically active, to breathe smoke-free air, and see alcohol no longer a central focus for so many adults. The opportunities are endless for us. We live in the largest landmass county in the state. We have a rich history of agriculture, and we value family and community. We can and we will do this together. This afternoon, we will hear from our candidates their perspectives on what opportunities lay before us and learn more about the public policies we can shape to ensure everyone can live better longer. So I want to thank you for your individual and collective efforts to make the difference for our children, our families, and our communities here in Marathon County. With that, I'm going to go ahead and introduce Eric Jordanel. is the director with Wisconsin Institute for Public Policy, and Eric will be moderating our candidate forum. So with that, I'll hand it off to you, Eric. Thank you.
Thank you, Joan. Welcome again to the UW Center for Civic Engagement, and we're so grateful for the campus at UW-Marathon County for hosting this event entitled Discussion on Critical Issues Facing Marathon County, Alcohol, Tobacco, and Obesity. At this time, we'd like to welcome our five candidates running to represent voters in central Wisconsin for seats in the State Assembly. Going to my immediate right and down the line, we have seeking to represent the 87th District, Elizabeth Riley, who's a Democrat. To her right, Democrat Dennis Halkowski, also seeking the Assembly seat from the 86th District. Libertarian Jim Moss, seeking to represent the 85th Assembly District. To his right, Democrat Mandy Wright, also seeking to represent the 85th Assembly District. And to her right, Republican Pat Snyder, also seeking to represent the 85th Assembly District. And certainly not least, Democrat Paul Knopf, seeking to represent the 69th Assembly District. So welcome, and let's give them a round of applause and thank them for being here today. It's really important to the citizens of Wisconsin to have you here, and we thank you for your participation, especially on these key issues to our community. The primary purpose of this afternoon's event is educational. Specifically, forum organizers desire to increase public awareness of key health behaviors by our citizens that make a difference in the quality of life in our communities. Now, our format today involves a citizen panel that I'll introduce momentarily, who will ask questions about alcohol, tobacco, and obesity. Candidates will have 2 minutes each to answer each question, and after they have had a chance to speak, we'll have a short free discussion segment in which candidates will have an opportunity to discuss the issue in more depth as time allows. We ask that the audience at this time silence all electronic devices. We also ask that you accord the speakers and each other the respect that we expect as fellow citizens in this great democracy by refraining from clapping, cheering, or making noise while candidates are speaking. Your cooperation is appreciated. At the conclusion of the moderated panel discussion, we will have time for a few audience questions. Volunteers have already circulated, I think you've heard, and they'll still be circulating with cards that they will collect on which you may write questions. If you desire to have a card, please just raise your hand and someone will come and give you a card. If you're ready to give the card back, then just hold it up and someone will come to collect that. At the conclusion of the forum, Karen Katz, the chair of Healthy Marathon County, will make a closing statement, and we will end promptly at 6 p.m. Now I'd like to introduce our citizen panel. To my immediate left is Sue Gantner, a member of our fine community. She will be asking questions today on the issue of obesity, correct?
Yes.
Okay. And to her left, I'd like to introduce Shelley Parcells, Director of Surgical Services at Ministry St. Clair's Hospital. She will be asking questions today about tobacco. And finally, to her left, Brad Gast, who's the Director of Continuing Education at North Central Technical College. He will be asking questions today about alcohol. So we'll begin tonight's discussion with the topic of alcohol use, so we'll start with Brad. I'll read a statement that was actually written by event organizers, and then we'll begin our question and answer period. When it comes to drinking, it seems no state keeps pace with Wisconsin. Wisconsin, long famous for its breweries, leads the nation in drunk driving, binge drinking, and the most bars per capita, all of which continue to create a huge economic toll on the state. In 2005, underage drinking cost the citizens of Wisconsin $1.2 billion. In 2008, costs for alcohol-related hospitalizations in Wisconsin were more than $1 billion. Wisconsin's alcohol culture encourages excessive, risky drinking, which has created negative impacts throughout the state for years, yet there continues to be a lack of change in legislation and policy to make significant impacts on Wisconsin's destructive alcohol culture. We'll now turn to Brad for our questions.
Thank you for coming. First question. Only the state of Wisconsin allows underage drinking in a licensed establishment if the alcohol is purchased by a parent, guardian, or spouse over the age of 21. Do you support eliminating this exception to Wisconsin's legal drinking age?
We'll begin the questioning, the answering, with Elizabeth Riley.
Thank you. Thank you for hosting this and for inviting my participation. I would support legislation to make it illegal for children under the age of 21 to drink alcoholic beverages in restaurants. I speak, well, not from my own experiences. I've been lucky. My children, who are now adults, fortunately did not have a problem with alcohol. Nobody drank, nobody expressed an interest in it. And I know this because their friends were always over at our house. My kids were actively involved in sports and in school and other programs, and I think that that actually helped keep them from that. But I was at a parade one day with a friend of mine and her 15-year-old son, and then my two sons who were 22 at the time. And it was a beautiful summer day, and we ordered an alcoholic beverage, and she ordered a beer for her son, and I said, "You can't do that. He runs cross country. It's a violation of the co-curricular code." My husband's the coach. And she said, "No, it's okay, it doesn't matter." And I thought about this afterwards. I mean, I didn't rat him out to my husband. But I thought about it afterwards, and I thought, what good can possibly come from the ability to legally buy your 15-year-old an alcoholic beverage? If you look at even something like brain development and brain function, you will know that at 15 years old, even at 21 years old, your brain is still developing. So there's no positive purpose to be gained from this. So I would support that legislation.
Thank you. We'll just go down the line. So, Mr. Halkowski.
Having a background in law enforcement, I have seen a lot of devastation caused by alcohol. This particular topic is something that I truly would like to examine for a number of reasons. First of all, if an adult purchases and serves a minor alcohol in a bar, and say it's a parent and a child, and they both happen to leave at the same time, however, going opposite directions, and the child is now on his own. I shouldn't say child, they can be 18, 19, 20 years old. That person is now, if he's driving a vehicle, in violation of absolute sobriety law in Wisconsin. I believe that if parents are giving their children alcohol, as Elizabeth said, I don't think it's a good idea for their development, first of all. Second of all, I believe that any number of tragic things can happen with them being on their own afterwards, unless that person, that parent has absolute control over that teenager when they leave. I see that as a problem. It's also been a problem in law enforcement where we have to follow up if we do happen to have contact with this underage person later and find that they've been consuming alcohol, and they tell us that, well, my parents actually gave it to me. We then have to find the parents to verify this. So that's more time taken up by law enforcement. So this is something I would definitely like to examine and see possibly some changes.
Thank you. Mr. Moss.
Thank you. Well, for a libertarian, this question has a number of issues. First of all, libertarians do not think the state of Wisconsin or the United States should be treating adults like children. The commonly accepted age of majority is 18. So 18, 19, and 20-year-olds should not be Class B adult citizens. They should be adults. They have the right to vote. They serve in the military. They can marry. They can sign contracts. Why would the state want to prevent these so-called underage adults from drinking an adult beverage. I don't understand that. The United States is one of only a handful of countries in the world that have raised their drinking age to 21. The others are such places like Indonesia, Kazakhstan, Oman, Pakistan, and some island country out in the Pacific. So the rest of the world has lower drinking ages or no drinking age at all, and somehow they are able to survive. This situation where an adult, a young adult, is out with their parents is even more disturbing. They could be at their wedding reception, and they can't have a glass of champagne even when their parents are present. The parents, you would think, would, in most cases, would be the person that would make a decision, and that's okay, except they're adults now, and the parents no longer have control over them.
Thank you. Mandy Wright?
Thank you for hosting this forum. Thank you for asking us these important questions about our community. Yes, I do support changing this legislation so that children cannot drink in public, cannot drink with their parents. I don't think it's appropriate. We have many examples. First of all, brain development is extremely important in children. As a teacher, I see how impulsive kids are every day, and we don't need to be adding alcohol into the mix of them developing and making decisions. Also, I think it's embarrassing, frankly, that Wisconsin and only some parts of Texas are the only states that allow this to happen. I think that there is good reason that this legislation is already passed in 48 other states. I also think we have plenty of examples right here in our community. This summer, there was an 18-year-old boy from Hatley who was driving, flipped his car. He had been drinking. He had three other teenagers in the car. One of them was his own sister, who was 13 years old. He knew he had done wrong, and he fled the scene. That boy now faces a felony conviction at the age of 18. He knows he did something wrong in retrospect, but he will have to pay the consequences for the rest of his life. And frankly, he's lucky that he didn't kill someone. That wasn't a decision that he probably would have made if he weren't under the influence of alcohol. We need to protect our communities, make sure that our kids can make good decisions, and for the health of everyone, make sure that we are setting a good example for our kids and not allowing them to drink.
Thank you. Pat Snyder.
Thanks, Eric. Thank you, Eric, and hi, everyone. I think I bring a unique addition to this panel. If you follow me on the radio, you know I am an alcoholic. My life-changing, I guess you could say, unveiling of this happened on July 29th, 2003. When I wrecked my motorcycle, got a DUI, and then was in the hospital for the next 2 weeks with a broken arm and broken leg. Why it took 25 years of binge drinking for me to realize that I had a problem, I don't know. I wrestle with that all the time. But now, coming from the alcoholic standpoint, I haven't had a drink in over 9 years. And I want to continue that. With my radio position and community awareness about myself, I use this as a channel to be very open about my addiction, as well as bringing folks on that could help prevent this, help educate. This atmosphere is one of heavy drinking. I remember growing up in Milwaukee, my relatives came in, and one of the stops was taking a tour of the brewery. And at the end, being able to, my uncles and dad drank the beer while we had the orange juice. The legislation about 21, I think 21 is 21. You need to be 21 to have a beverage. And I think that is proper to make it a statewide legislation. Communities have done a good job, as they are already starting to crack down on parents that host parties with alcohol. So I think the education and some of the prevention that are being taken, and really this comes to the parents and the individual to take responsibility on that. And I would bring that unique fight to a legislative session from my own experience in this battle. Thanks.
Thank you. Paul Knopf?
Well, thank you, first of all, for having us here. This is a great opportunity. And I just want to say, Pat and I have a similar background in our professional careers. We both were radio people, and I have to say that I'm very, very impressed by Pat's answer on this topic, because that's a hard thing to talk about. The fact is that we do have a problem. We have a culture of drinking in this state, and I serve on the Clark County Prevention Partnership. You talked about the Parents That Host the Most campaign. That's something that our group does. We try to put peer pressure not only on kids not to drink, but we try to put peer pressure on adults not to host gatherings where kids are going to get together and drink. I think the biggest thing we have, the biggest hurdle that we have right now, is that culture. Folks come to this state, and I've had the opportunity to talk to a lot of people over the years, and people come from out of state to Wisconsin, and they say this is unlike our state completely. I had a friend that came from the state of New York, and the first thing that she mentioned about this topic was, in New York, if you get caught with a DUI, it is you're the black sheep. It's a terrible thing. In Wisconsin, you get a DUI, and it's as if you've joined the Brotherhood. And I don't think that's the right way to go about it. We really need to focus on this issue. As for this particular issue, certainly would be open to that. I would like to see some studies to make sure, as Jim said, I will say that I agree somewhat with Jim that you have to be careful with certain social gatherings. You don't want to invade into personal family tradition too much. But if you're going out to a retail establishment to purchase a beverage, I think I'd be very open to making sure that kids under the age of 21 could not be served alcoholic beverages.
Thank you, and we're making good time, and we will have some time left over to discuss a little more in depth, but why don't we go straight to question two, and Brad, thank you.
Thank you. Sobriety checkpoints have resulted in significant decreases in drunk driving. 38 states have used this successful strategy. Would you support changes that allow local law enforcement in Wisconsin to utilize this approach?
This time we're going to go in reverse order, so Paul, if you wouldn't mind.
Well, obviously this is a very controversial topic in Wisconsin because of what I said before. We have a culture of drinking, and we have one of the very strong lobbying organizations in the state is the Wisconsin Tavern League. The Wisconsin Tavern League has really put the kibosh on a lot of common sense legislation that I think would reduce the amount of drinking that we have in the state and reduce the amount of problems that we have with, you know, as a news director, I have to tell you, some of the most gut-wrenching stories I covered were drunk driving-related deaths, because typically you had friends in the same car, or in one case, I remember a very, very gut-wrenching story of a woman that was driving her mother after a night out at the bar and flipped the car on an icy road, killed her mother, and as Mandy said, this woman fled into a nearby barn because she was so distraught over what happened. These are the stories that repeat themselves over and over again. However, there is no, I don't think there's public will right now for sobriety checkpoints in the state of Wisconsin. I think the best thing to do is continue education and try to chip away at some of the inroads the Tavern League has made, because they have made huge inroads. And this might seem like a completely off-topic discussion, but it gets to campaign finance reform for me. These special interest lobbying firms have so much leverage in how our bills are crafted, and I think that's why we haven't seen some common sense reforms as far as drinking and driving are concerned in Wisconsin.
Thank you. Pat?
I would not be for the sobriety checkpoints. If I understand it correctly, the newspaper has to report that these checkpoints, where they're going to be and what time they're going to be. Since my time, since I've been sober now, I've been out and actually heard people warn others about the checkpoint and what to do. I still am one that likes to see a probable cause to pull somebody over. And going on a ride-along with the Wausau police about a year or two ago, they can tell. I asked them about how difficult it was to see the drunk driver. And for the most part, it's their manpower, the number, you know, five, six officers out in a shift. But I think Dennis could probably attribute to this too when it comes down to him. But when it comes to sobriety checkpoints, that is infringing on some of the rights of people that don't drink at all. As far as some of the responsibility, I know the Marathon County Tavern League, they're the second most in the state for putting the Safe Ride Home program. $70,000 collected from the members for a Safe Ride Home program last year, and that is great. We need to be active and really intervene. If someone's had too much of the bar, I think our culture is that we're a little shy from confronting them. Well, we have to say, listen, take the Safe Ride Home, come back and get your vehicle tomorrow. I think as individuals, we are a little bit more forceful in defending the people out on the roadway from the drunk driver, from even getting into the vehicle. That'll be a lot. But again, speaking as the alcoholic, we don't think we have a problem. And that comes to the point of hitting rock bottom and understanding the disease that we have. So no to the sobriety points, but I would put a lot more in for the police enforcement of getting the probable cause.
Thank you. Mandy?
This is not something I think we should leave to individuals. Obviously, individuals don't make good decisions when they are under the influence of alcohol, and we can't expect somebody else to just encourage them to take a safe ride. I think that's a nice option. But in the end, we need stricter enforcement because this is really hurting our community. We have far too many deaths, and other people are put at risk on our roadways. As far as actual sobriety checkpoints, this is something I would like to look into more. This is something I would like to have more time to do some research on, talk to constituents, see what really works. Another option may be high visibility enforcement. This summer we saw that in action. And not only is it a deterrent when we have high visibility enforcement, but it does actually catch more people. And I'm sure there are other options on the table. So yes, I do think that we should figure out ways to deter people from drinking and driving. I'm just not sure that this is exactly the right one. I'd like to hear from people on this topic.
Thank you. Jim?
Okay, well, treating every driver like they're a suspect of doing something wrong is really a bad idea. And one of the problems with that is in our Constitution, it says the right of the people to be secure in their persons, houses, papers, and effects against unreasonable searches and seizures shall not be violated. That's the Fourth Amendment to the Constitution. That's to protect everybody. These checkpoints are not an effective deterrent. They're not an effective technique. The most effective technique to catch drunk drivers is roving patrols. And when you have checkpoints, it's an unnecessary waste of manpower and money to pull those patrols off the road and put them in one place. So that's a really important thing to consider. The deterrence doesn't work. They, as somebody said, they find out where these checkpoints are and avoid them. What the checkpoints do, evidently, is it gives the police a chance to stop them, and because they aren't impaired enough, now that it's the blood alcohol content thing is down to 0.08, they aren't necessarily impaired, and they aren't weaving, but if you stop them and test them, they might be able to find some alcohol. We've known for years that the serious accidents are all with the blood alcohol level of 0.14 or better. So the checkpoints is a really bad idea and we should avoid it.
Thank you. Dennis?
Coming from a law enforcement background, this is a very, very important subject to me. I've had to wake parents up at 3 o'clock in the morning and tell them that their child was killed in an accident. I have had to pull people out of cars that I knew. Drunk driving is a problem, not only in Wisconsin, but across this country. This is a subject we need to take seriously. This is something that needs to be examined. But I will say this, that there are a number of traffic grants issued to police departments in this area year-round, particularly for drunk driving patrols. It's paid overtime. It's state and federal money that's put into this. And as Jim alluded to, the roving patrols do seem to be, when they're targeting drunk drivers, do seem to be very effective. Statistics will show that. Also, right now we would have to change the state law because an officer needs reasonable cause to stop a vehicle for anything. This would put a strain on local budgets. You would need to pay officers overtime. There's more than one person obviously needed at a checkpoint. So there are a number of factors to consider here, and this is something we need to discuss. And I'm not saying it's a bad thing or a good thing. I'm saying we need to discuss this and look at all the positives and negatives and come to an informed decision.
Thank you. Elizabeth.
I have to agree with my colleagues here who are talking about sort of a find out from people what others think about it before you go ahead and say, yes, this is something I would support or not support. As a nurse and as somebody who has worked in emergency departments, I too have some really horrific stories to tell that involve drinking and driving. And I know from living in Hayward and reading our local paper, the number of people on the jail page that have a fifth or a sixth offense. And to me, that's very troublesome. But rather than looking at it specifically from a law enforcement point of view, I would like to take sort of the healthcare point of view and see alcoholism for a disease. I don't think anybody wakes up in the morning and says, you know what I want to do? I want to get that sixth drunk driving tonight. I just don't think people think that way. Alcoholism is a disease and frequently is accompanied by other underlying mental illnesses. So Paul talked about campaign finance being at issue here and lobbyists holding large sway over policies that happen or don't happen. And healthcare is a huge policy. I know we're gonna be, this is all encompassing. And when I see people who have a disease, my first thought is they need to be treated. And alcoholism is a tough disease. Treatment doesn't always work the first time or the second time or even the third time. But we have to look in terms of treatment because these are actual human beings with lives who want to function and be contributing members of society. So I don't know where I'd sit on the checkpoints unless I talk to people, but we need to treat the underlying causes.
Thank you. Well, we're just going to take a few minutes to have some discussion here. Based on things that you've heard your fellow candidates say or thinking about the issue generally, are there any comments that you have or would like to make? Paul.
I do have a comment because I have a bit of a libertarian streak myself, and I understand where Jim is coming from here, but the concern that I have with Jim's argument is when we're in our vehicles, we're using a public facility, we're using our public roadways, and everybody, I think that's a good philosophical debate to have. Don't we have a right to be safe from our fellow motorists? And I'd be interested to see where Jim stands there as a libertarian.
Well, I think the number of people on the highway who are a threat and are impaired enough to risk lives on the highway is very small. And when we're passing laws that apply to the entire adult population, that makes me very uncomfortable, especially since year after year, the Wisconsin Department of Transportation, I think it is, puts out a year-end report on traffic safety, and for years in a row, they announced that the highway death toll has been the lowest it's been since World War II. So I don't accept the blood on the highway story. There are lots of terrible tales about this and personal stories, but overall, I think Wisconsin's highways are safer than they have been before. I think we're having less drunk driving than we had before. And so I think the sensational headlines are deceiving.
Thank you. Anyone else like to comment?
I would just say that I agree with Jim in part that our highways have become safer somewhat, but every year there are more motorists on the highway. Also, there has been an impact on drunk driving, definitely. Statistics will show that also. However, if it is your family or a member of your family that is the victim of a drunk driver, I think you may have a different view on just that one person or very few people being out there driving drunk. That one person can devastate an entire family.
Okay, thank you. Why don't we go ahead and move forward then? And I'd like to ask Brad, if he would, to ask his third question. And because we're running short on time, I'd like to call this a bit of a speed round. And so if you could try to answer this question, because it is sort of a yes or no question, but in 10 words or less, and then we can keep on track, okay? That's right, you do have to buzz in, right. Yeah. Thank you, Brad.
And unfortunately, the question itself is about 100 words long, so, <That's right. laughs> so bear with me, please. Wisconsin has the highest rates of both drunk driving and binge drinking in the country. Alcohol abuse places significant costs on all taxpayers by burdening limited resources for local law enforcement. Would you consider supporting law enforcement and alcohol abuse prevention by raising the price of alcohol?
Okay, let's start with Jim, and then we'll come my way, and then we'll go back the other way.
Raising taxes, is that your question?
Specifically, raising the price of alcohol.
Okay. Well, first of all, on the binge drinking thing, I think that this is a government definition of binge drinking. I think is 5 drinks in 3 hours or something like that. So if you sit down at the Packer game and have a beer each quarter, according to the government, you're on a binge, whereas the medical definition would be you're totally irresponsible, self-destructive, staggering around, can't work, can't socialize effectively for at least a day or two at a time. That's a binge. So I don't accept that definition of the binge, and I don't want to raise the taxes on Wisconsinites.
Thank you. Don't forget it's a speed round. Dennis?
I'm not going to make a definitive yes or no answer here. What I'm going to say is that it's something that needs to be examined. I have seen families devastated economically by alcohol, either alcoholism itself or a drunk driving accident, or what have you. I believe that education and enforcement are important in the process also. And again, we need to examine all the facts and make informed decisions.
Thank you. Elizabeth?
What he said. actually, no, I honestly thought that he summed up my feelings very well. I can't commit one way or to the other on whether I think raising the price of alcohol is going to make a dent in it. I don't know what studies say. I don't know what people think. I certainly think we have to focus on prevention. I don't know if raising the price of alcohol will do that.
Thank you. Paul?
Well, I will just cut to the chase. Nobody's going to commit to raising taxes, because if we do, our opponent is going to take that little snippet and put it on a mailer that you're going to get 1,000 times before November 6th. That's the world we live in. So when you hear us being elusive, just know that that is what is happening here, okay? So I'm going to say, I need more information. I need to do more research, and that's what everybody is going to say. The fact of it is, I did some stories on this very topic. Therese Brousseau introduced a bill that would have raised the tax on alcohol. And of course, she was criticized, and Republicans put out press releases calling her un-American or certainly un-Wisconsinite for implying such a thing. But of course, the tax on alcohol is so minuscule, and it's never been indexed, I don't think, for an inflation. I don't think it's been increased in years and years and years and years. But having said that, I'm not going to take a stand one way or the other and have that stand then put out in a bunch of robocalls and on TV stations and on WSAU and everything else. But I will say this. I'm very fortunate. My parents didn't drink when I was a kid, and I grew up in a culture where there was no drinking. And my friends didn't drink, and we stuck together. And we made sure, because we had seen our other friends go down some really bad paths already in high school. And I think what you need is more people that are going to lead by example. And that's definitely something that I think is very effective. And that's a message that, I'm sorry, this is a speed round, I forgot. It's a message I'll take to students and kids.
Thank you. Yeah. Pat? I would definitely talk with my fellow legislators and consider this. And if something like this did occur, I would want to make sure that the tax that would be added to it would go to the prevention and not to the general fund. So it would serve the purpose it was supposed to serve.
Thank you, Pat. Mandy, last word.
I do think this is something important to consider. Wisconsin's beer tax has not changed since 1969, as well as we rank 48th in taxes of the 50 states. So we're one of the lowest in taxes. I think those are very important things to consider, and I do think we need to support law enforcement and we need to support alcohol abuse prevention. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, let's move quickly to tobacco.
But before that, by the way, you pay $7.50 a beer at the Packer games. So, and there are people that are buying three or
That's
four
a
of these.
Special Packers tax, right? Okay. Again, we'll start this round by reading a brief statement, and then we'll turn to our questioner. Tobacco use is the leading preventable cause of death, disease, and disability across the United States and in our area. Smoke-free work policies and increased taxes are two of the proven strategies that have lowered the rate of smoking from 1 in 3 adults a decade ago to 1 in 5 adults today. However, healthcare costs associated with tobacco use remain high at approximately $64 million a year in Marathon County alone. As a result of lost revenue, tobacco companies are developing new products, including fruit flavoring and smokeless products, to attract the attention of a new generation of potential users. And 1 in 2 children, as well as vulnerable populations, still suffer from the effects of secondhand smoke. There remains a role for all of us to play in further reducing the toll tobacco takes on families, businesses, and communities in central Wisconsin. Our questioner will be Shelley Parcells.
Currently, the state spends approximately $1.6 billion in healthcare costs related to tobacco use every year. The state also collects close to $800 million in tax revenue related to tobacco sales. My first question is, do you think it is reasonable that at least 5% of that revenue should be used to prevent kids from starting to smoke and to support smoking cessation programs for adults? Second part of the question is, do you have any other ideas on how we could support prevention of smoking?
Okay, we'll start this round with Paul Knopf, and we'll move forward down the line.
Actually, I pronounce it Knopf, so just
if
you've had enough, vote for Knopf. That's what I'm talking about. Where my parents weren't drinkers, they were smokers and are still smokers, and that has been a huge deterrent for me, and I have not started smoking, in large part because of living in that atmosphere. Off the top of my head and looking at this proposal, 5% seems very reasonable to me. I think any amount of money that we spend preventing kids from smoking is going to save us money down the road, because we all know that whether we admit it or not, we have somewhat of a socialized form of medicine, and that all the cost is spread around once we go into the hospital facility. So we need to make sure that we're preventing folks from starting from an early age. That's when habits are developed, and I think 5% sounds like a very reasonable amount. As far as other ideas for prevention, being on the Clark County Prevention Partnership, we're constantly brainstorming ways of going out to schools and talking to people about smoking, drug use, alcohol abuse, and that sort of thing. And I think that I'm new to the Marathon County. Is it Healthy Marathon County? Is that what the group is called? But it sounds like it's a great, great organization. And I'm not sure if you have any dissemination grant money, but I'm sure other counties around the state would love to hear how well you guys are doing, and we can work at it from there.
Thank you. Pat.
Yes, I would support part of the 5% of the revenues that's collected from the tobacco tax to go to prevention. Seems rather minuscule right now. This is kind of one of those double-edged swords. The more you educate, the more you cut down on smoking, the less the tobacco tax will get less funds, so we're going to have to figure out ways of funding the state without that. But when you consider the health benefits of people not smoking, that does seem to weigh in very well. I just, in this day and age, as much as we hear about how bad smoking is and what it can do, that there are still kids that want to smoke. I imagine my parents also smoked. My dad gave it up about 10 years ago finally, and feels great. But not being a smoker, I don't know what it's like to be addicted to nicotine and to try to give that up, and how tough that might be. So to be able to educate, especially at that young age, like the DARE programs do with drugs and alcohol, I think definitely is something to explore. And I would say yes, that part of that tobacco tax fund should go to that 5%.
Thank you. Mandy?
I certainly think that 5% is a reasonable amount to spend on educating and keeping our kids healthy. I think we can support the DARE program and look into other programs that have been proven successful. As far as other options, I learned that tobacco spends $274 million on marketing each year, and only $5 million on education. So maybe we could ask the tobacco companies themselves if they could help us fund some prevention programs. Possibly we need a tax targeted particularly on the corporation themselves. In addition, I just met this past weekend again with the 18 Clan Council, which is leadership of the Hmong community from around the state. And I asked them, are there any particular issues you would like me to represent you on? And this is exactly what came up. Heart disease is a leading killer in the Hmong community. Many of the veterans picked up smoking while they were in Southeast Asia, and it continues to plague the community here in Wisconsin. So I think there are many, many ways that we can work to prevent tobacco use. And I think it's not just about educating our children, but it's also about providing services and opportunities to adults in the community to choose healthier lifestyles for themselves and for their families.
Thank you. Jim?
I have no objection to the 5% going to prevention efforts, but I'd like to see what those efforts specifically would be before I'd give total approval. I think we need a little more research on that. And then as far as ideas for prevention, what worked for me, when my dad quit cold turkey, he had an open pack of unfiltered Camels that he put in the drawer. So when I got older, 15 years later, I pulled that out. I thought I'd try an unfiltered, dried out Camel cigarette, and that deterred me. So I think we should go around to the schools and give kids unfiltered Camel cigarettes, and the problem would be solved.
Okay. Dennis?
And Paul, just so you know, I'm not hedging my bet on this one. Okay. I've done a little research on this, actually, and did some checking, and I did a comparative study with Wisconsin and Minnesota, similar size populations. The tax on a pack of cigarettes in Wisconsin is $2.52. In Minnesota, it's $1.58. And yet, Minnesota spends a total of $21,134,000 per year on funding for tobacco control programs. The state of Wisconsin spends a grand total of $7,555,000. Minnesota, their tax is a dollar less pack of cigarettes, and yet they spend three times as much on tobacco control programs. I think that says something about our system, the way it's being run now. Do I agree that it should be raised? Again, I'd like to do a little more research, but just this little bit that I've done here. I've also taken a look at people that have quit recently and why they quit. The reason is because the taxes have gone up on cigarettes. The price has gone astronomically high for some of them, and they can't afford it, so they quit smoking. The hardcore smokers, just like the hardcore binge drinkers, are not going to be deterred by the amount of taxes you put on something. But I will say that I think we should definitely look at funding more for our control programs, for smoking control programs in this state.
Thank you. Elizabeth?
To me, 5% does not sound unreasonable at all. I think it should be more than that, put toward programs for prevention for young people and cessation for adults. One of the things that I always think is that tobacco companies are a little bit like computer hackers or terrorists. Every time you think you've got them stopped, they find a new way to get around the technology. And some of the products that they're marketing now to little kids are scary. They look just like candy. I had a conversation with somebody earlier today, and there was a little stand out there that had some of these products on them. They look just like candy. And they're marketed to little kids. And as long as they're going to do that, people will become addicted. And kids and teenagers especially, who are more likely, again, brain developmentally wise, to become addicted, are some of the most vulnerable victims of that kind of marketing. So I would certainly support 5% of that going to prevention. I also like the idea of a tax on corporations that manufacture these products, because these are products that they're the only products I know of, really, where if you use them the way they want you to use them, you will die. To me, it just sort of makes sense that corporations that are in the business of killing people should actually have to pay for that.
Okay. Thank you very much. We'll go to question two.
My second question is related to taxes again. The current tax on the candy-flavored cigarettes and cigars that are on display out there, and for anybody who hasn't seen it, I recommend you go look at it, because it's very difficult to tell a cigar from a pack of gum or chewing tobacco or anything like that. So check that out before you leave. But the current tax on the candied flavored cigars is 71% of the wholesale price of the product. In many cases, this represents pennies in tax dollars. The state cigarette tax, as was spoken before, was $2.52 per pack. Since the harm to the user is substantially the same as and it also costs the state millions of dollars, would you support a proposal to make all tobacco products taxed at the same rate as cigarettes?
Okay, for this round, we'll start with Mandy, and we'll go to the right.
Thank you. Clearly, this is unbalanced, and we need to create balance taxing tobacco products at a similar rate, at least. I also agree with Elizabeth's comments that tobacco companies are dangerous, and when we are creating products that entice children in particular, obviously they are trying to create lifelong users of their products, and so we need to be especially careful how we treat these products that are clearly marketed towards children. As a mother of three daughters. As a teacher of sixth graders, I think of all the time and energy we put into growing healthy, safe, responsible kids, and how much this kind of addiction can hurt a person in their growth and in their future. I think it's really important that we do everything we can to deter kids from becoming addicted to tobacco.
Thank you. Pat?
Yeah, I think that the tax should be on a level playing field with all the tobacco, and so I would consider that with my fellow legislators to look into that. And you still have to be 18 to be able to purchase this tobacco, and otherwise they're getting help by someone older. So there's more, I guess, to look at than just the youngster. We have to look at who's supplying someone who's not 18, because I know I've been to Quick Trip and they always ask for an ID if someone is purchasing tobacco. So we'll make sure that those establishments continue that, but then also, do we go further and go after an adult who's older than 18 buying something for someone younger? Things always to consider and to look at it at that. And but as far as a level playing field, tobacco tax should be equal for all.
Thank you, Paul.
Well, if Pat Snyder's all in on increasing taxes, I guess I can be too. I think leveling off the playing field is probably a good idea. And I do want to bring up one story. As Elizabeth was talking, I think we've all probably knocked on thousands of doors already this year. And one door that I came to was a gentleman in Marshfield, a guy that I actually went to school with but hadn't seen for a long time. And he was outside of his house, and he started to smoke a cigarette. And he asked me, Paul, how do you feel about these things? And I thought, uh-oh, here we go. You know, what do you think of the tax on cigarettes? And I was trying to hedge a little bit, Dennis, and I said, well, how do you feel about cigarettes? And he said, I want you to outlaw them because they're killing me and I can't stop. And he said exactly what Elizabeth said. What other product can you buy on the market? He used that exact line, and it struck me that you can use and die from using it. Having said that, that little voice in the back of my head says, my parents are a great example where they have tried and tried and tried to quit smoking, and they can't do it. They're hooked. They've gone through all the treatments, and the tax has been very penal to them. We've stopped as a family, and maybe we shouldn't have, but we've stopped trying to get them to stop because it's difficult as a family to talk about that sort of thing when you know that they're emotionally troubled by the fact that they can't quit too. So again, answering the question, I think, yeah, leveling the playing field and making sure those products that are specifically targeted to kids, that's very low, as we say in the business. So I would agree with Pat Snyder.
Thank you. Elizabeth.
I would support leveling that to make it the same tax too, to bring the candy flavored products up to the same tax as other products have. I look at the health benefits or the health problems that result of smoking, COPD. Many people automatically think of lung cancer when they think of smoking, but the cardiovascular disease is absolutely astounding in how bad it is and how long people suffer with it, and that can lead to things like congestive heart failure and all kinds of other chronic conditions that are really horrible. So anything we can do, I think, to deter people from buying these products, and if that means raising the prices on them, they should be.
Thank you. Dennis?
I agree with a number of things that have been said here. Obviously, these types of products are targeted to our young people. And even if they're not able to buy them, if at 18 years old they can buy this, it may be something that they can stomach. Something that if they want to try a cigarette, it's not so bad. It has a little flavoring to it. I think I can handle this. So I believe that the playing field, like everyone else here, should be leveled. Tobacco products should be taxed the same rate, no matter what they are.
Thank you. And Jim, the last word on this topic?
Well, I think taxing similar products at the same rate seems fair to me. I'll just point out, though, that taxing them the same, you have to be careful of what you ask for, because you might get it and it might not be taxed at the highest rate. It might be taxed at a much lower rate or a medium rate. So who knows what's going to happen after such a proposal gets through the legislature.
Thank you. We just have a couple minutes here for some free flow discussion. Is there anything that's been said that you'd like to comment on, or any additional thoughts that you've had since we've been discussing tobacco? Okay, seeing none, we'll go ahead to question three.
Wisconsin residents have shown a significant support, 75% in the recent polls, for smoke-free air in the 2 years since all workers and patrons were protected from secondhand smoke. Additionally, research has shown that workers most exposed to secondhand smoke in the past are already benefiting from improved health outcomes. How would you help to ensure that this popular and successful approach is continued?
And if we could, just to keep on track, could we keep our responses to 1 minute, please? Elizabeth.
I really don't know how to answer that question. I don't know what I personally would do to make sure that we continue to have this law that says you can't smoke in public places. Certainly, as a healthcare professional, as a citizen, and as someone who does not want to breathe somebody else's smoky air, I was very happy when we finally got the ability to outlaw cigarettes in public places. You could go to a restaurant and have a meal and the smoking section smoke didn't come back to you or whatever. So I don't know that we're in any danger of having that law changed. If I ever heard noises that people wanted to change it, I would be on my hind legs to keep it in. So that's what I'll say.
Thank you. Dennis?
And I have to concur with Elizabeth. I don't see any efforts being made to reverse this. And I just wanted to bring attention to something called the LIFE Report. It stands for Local Indicators for Excellence. And it's put out, it's a survey done in Marathon County every 2 years. The statewide, it's popular by 75% of the people. Here in Marathon County, it's 86% of the people agree with smoke-free environments. So the local reaction here is important to me. These are the people I'll be representing. And no way are we going back to what we had before.
Thank you. Jim?
Well, I'm not aware of any effort to eliminate that law. Frankly, for a libertarian, the law, I think, went too far in a number of ways. It violates the private property rights of the owners of businesses, which you call public, but they're privately owned, and so that's a problem for libertarians. The local control was eliminated. We had some communities that decided to ban smoking, some didn't, and so people had choices. And libertarians would say that people should have a choice and accept the consequences and accept responsibility for what happens. And the thing that really bothers me is they applied this no smoking law to the smoking lounge in the Wisconsin Veterans Home, which was completely ventilated. And these old guys that are spending the last years of their life, hopefully in comfort, are required now to either quit or go outside in the winter or in the summer. So I think that bothers me.
Thank you. Mandy?
I can tell you that I have had personal experience. I've been pregnant with 3 children in this community, and when I wanted to go out for a Friday night fish fry, it was often awkward because the restaurant that we would choose would be connected to a bar, and there would be smoking there, and I always felt uncomfortable. I am really glad, not just for myself, but for all community members, especially the people working in those conditions, that we have passed this law, that it's very strong, that there's a lot of community support, and if necessary, I would find strong advocates, resources like we have at this table, to make sure that we continue this law.
Thank you.
Yeah, I agree that the bar owners and restaurant owners know that this this is very popular, and I have not heard any of them wanting to go back. They have made the arrangements, building on the separate buildings for the smokers or just letting them go outside. But they said that they don't expect this to go back. And a lot of people do like to be able to go out and come home smoke-free from their clothes. So I don't anticipate, and I would not support any legislation to repeal this.
Thank you.
Yeah, this law is not going anywhere. I'm going to say that I like to be contrarian sometimes, and I know what Jim is saying, that this is not a ban on smoking in public places. It's a smoking ban in private places. And I struggled with that a little bit because I do know Jim's concerns, and I actually share those concerns that you don't want the government to get too overbearing on private property. But here's the difference. It's a ban on smoking in workplaces. And that's how I've come to understand this law, and it makes good sense. If somebody was working in a plastics factory, we would be ashamed if we forced those people to breathe in the fumes from the plastic. There would be heck to pay. This law is not going anywhere. Very popular. Bar owners like it. And I'll counter Jim just a little bit here. Bar owners didn't like the local patchwork that they had, because you had a bar owner on the fringe of Marshfield that was inside a smoking ban area, and just down the road they were in the town of McMillan and they could allow smoking. So they liked the level playing field.
Well, thank you. And I'd also like to thank all the candidates for keeping within your time limits. It's much appreciated, and we're right on schedule. So we'll now turn to the topic of obesity. And I'll read a short statement here for the questions. Currently, 63% of Marathon County residents are either obese or overweight. Obesity puts people at higher risk for other chronic diseases, such as diabetes and heart disease, and places a financial burden on us via medical expenses. Creating environments where we live, work, and play that encourage exercise, provide access to good nutrition, and support healthy behaviors are all ways to help fight this epidemic. So we'll now turn to Sue Gantner with our questions.
If trends continue, close to half of Wisconsinites will be obese in our lifetimes. So the first question is, do you believe that obesity prevention is a problem for individuals to deal with, or that government should play a role in prevention by creating healthier environments?
Let's go ahead and start with Jim Moss this time.
Yeah, libertarians would say this is not a government problem, this is a personal problem, and people should take individual responsibility for their health and their weight. But when we're talking about problems of obesity, I think, first of all, if you're presenting this as a possible legislative problem, we would have to find out why people are becoming obese or becoming more obese now than they were, 25, 50 years ago. What is the problem? The obesity is a symptom of something, and I'm not sure what it is. And I wouldn't want the state government to try to fix something unless we had a whole lot more information.
Okay, and we'll go down with Mandy and continue in that direction.
This is a situation where I'd like to see the focus more on education than legislation. From my perspective as a teacher, I can tell you that we've made a lot of progress. We just got a federal PEP grant, which allowed the school district to significantly improve their programming for physical education. I also think we can do things on the community level. There are significant improvements being made in our bike and pedestrian paths, and I'd like to see that improve even more because it leads to a stronger, healthier, more welcoming community. Personally, I approximately 3 years ago went in for a health risk assessment. It was provided free of charge through my job, and I did not realize just how heavy I had become. That was a turning point in my life because when I found out just what was happening with my health and the health risk factors, including diabetes and heart disease, I took it upon myself to change my diet, to change my exercise regimen, and lost a significant amount of weight over the course of about 2 years. I think it's a great example for what we could be doing for other people, because I think a lot of people in our community simply don't realize just how unhealthy they are. And need to understand the implications of their health choices. So I would like to see a focus on education and prevention, and I certainly would like to hear more ideas about how we can tackle this difficult issue.
Thank you. Pat?
Well, I know that I have a problem with obesity myself. When I was at the beach and two kids came up and said, hurry, let's push it back in before it dies. But in any case, I am for the educational part, especially when it comes to parents. You know, we talk about healthy choices, which are so important, but in this lifestyle we've suddenly become, when our kids are in sports, in activities, and we're running, I hate to say it, at least in my family, we got a little lazy. It was easy to run through a McDonald's or a fast food establishment and have dinner late. So really the burden was more on us, the parents. You know, we didn't go the extra mile maybe and make the meal at home. It was convenience. I think we have to reach out to parents to be able to get more involved in making their menu selections and providing the dinner. But I do think that as far as legislation goes, we can be the ones that educate, especially in the schools. And also physical education, I was glad to hear that some activity is going to that point, because I remember when I was in school, we had to like climb a rope to the ceiling. We were doing things that were incredible. The presidential fitness, get that award from the president, those type of things. And I think if we got our kids a little bit more active, maybe they would follow into a routine of exercise, because I noticed that really when I noticed my weight gain was my late 20s. And they always say it's the freshman 15, too, when you go into college. So education, but I don't like the mandate part when it comes to government.
Thank you. Paul?
Yes, I would echo Mandy and Pat when they talk about education. I think that's important. And, of course, we're talking about this issue at a time when we have some controversial new lunch guidelines at school, which you guys have probably heard about. And I'm a school board member, and last night we had a school board meeting, and we had some angry parents there. The discussion was, and where I would agree with some of the parents that were upset, it seems to be a one-size-fits-all policy right now. I think it was extremely well-intentioned, but you do have high school athletes that don't feel they're getting enough caloric intake to get them through practice. And I think that that's okay. We're going to work our way through this eventually, and we're going to come to a good solution. But at the outset of programs like this, every once in a while, government can appear a little bit clumsy, and it appears a little bit clumsy right now. But with the argument that I've heard over these new lunch standards, I don't think is a winning argument. The argument goes something like this. My kids are my kids. I should have a right to get them whatever kind of food they want at school. That is still true. You can send your kids the worst lunch you can possibly imagine in a brown paper bag. But if the government is providing the food, it's not an infringement of your freedom if the government provides you healthy food. So I think that there is a role for government to play. We have public programs like the school lunch program. They should be providing healthy food. Instead of a chicken McNugget platter covered in batter, we should be giving them something healthier than that.
Thank you. Elizabeth?
Talking about prevention, I think it is multi-pronged. I think government has a role, and I think, of course, individuals have a role as well. And in schools, the lunch program is one thing. But I think it's really difficult to improve healthcare unless we improve our food system and the way we grow food, which brings up a whole host and the kinds of food we grow. And that brings up a whole host of issues that are not really related to this. But I think that certainly with the huge cuts to education that we've seen in Wisconsin, what you see is the elimination of recess, the elimination of gym class, and things that are important for physical fitness. So we need to be able to bring those back. And I also think at the school level, we do teaching on eating disorders and what to watch out for as far as anorexia and bulimia, but nobody talks about basic overeating in school education programs, or if they do, I have not seen that. I think that we need to approach our insurance providers, public and private insurance entities, and have them pick up some of the burden of prevention and education. There's a condition that in healthcare we refer to as diabesity, because obesity is a huge factor for type 2 diabetes, and kids are getting type 2 diabetes at, you know, 6-7 years old these days, and type 1 diabetes used to be specifically called juvenile diabetes. And so I think we need to look at our food systems as well as our health systems in order to address this.
Okay, thank you. And Dennis?
I recall President John Kennedy emphasizing physical activity, physical fitness in schools back in the early 1960s. And Pat's right. When I was in school, I remember having to do all these things. It was constant activity during gym class. I don't know what they're doing now, but I do know that we as parents also have a responsibility. When our children are home, let's admit it, folks, most of the time they're in front of the TV with the Xbox or whatever video game system they have, and that's their life. We need to, as a family, get them involved in physical activity. Go for a walk, play a sport, take a basketball out, shoot some hoops, throw a football around or a baseball. So there's responsibility in all angles here. And government does have somewhat of a responsibility to help out. But I don't believe that the problem lies with the government. I believe it lies with all of us in our personal lives and how we decide to live those lives. We have to think of our children. I know I woefully lacked in a number of areas as a parent when my kids were growing up. And fortunately, they turned out okay. But I do see some things that I would have done differently. We need more physical activity for our children, more brain activity for our children, rather than just mindless video games and television.
Thank you. Turn back to Sue.
Children at schools with farm-to-school programs are more likely to eat fruit and vegetables at lunch. So the second question is, do you believe that the state of Wisconsin should provide more funding to local communities for farm-to-school efforts?
Let's begin with Pat Snyder, and then we'll come towards me. Mandy next.
Well, this is a, before I left the radio, I had talked with someone from, I believe, the Marshfield area about this farm-to-school program. It is intriguing. As far as the funding goes, if a school district would, instead of using funds to purchase from where they get their food, would rather turn it to this, then I'd be all for it. Local control and their decision to make that. I do know it's a healthier choice, and I do know that they've had some early success with that. But this would be an area, I think, that definitely would be willing to explore with fellow legislators and see if it would provide the healthy alternative.
Andy?
First of all, I think it's important to support our local agriculture and local farmers. I'm meeting farmers all the time who are telling me that they can't make a living running the family farm anymore. So I think this could be really excellent for helping small farms in dairy, beef, all sorts of different commodities to really have a better market.
I also, since I'm in the schools every day, I actually eat school lunch, lo and behold. especially on the campaign trail, I just don't have time to make my lunch these days. So I know that in the schools, they work very hard to make sure that those lunches are healthy, but they are prepackaged foods. And we could clearly do better in providing nutrition to our children, especially when we know that over half of the students in the Wausau School District now qualify for free and reduced lunch. Many of those children come in for breakfast with the school. If that's the majority of their nutritional intake, we really need to do a better job, because the food that we are providing is not the most nutritious we can provide. And we can do better. We are in the middle of Wisconsin. We are known for our agriculture. So this is an obvious thing that we should really work very hard on. I'm also a member of community-supported agriculture, and that is a farm where you buy in at the beginning of the year, and then you receive a share of the produce every week. And that has made my family significantly healthier. I think it is something we should explore. I've also worked with friends of mine have written the Farm to School program in Athens and implemented it. So I know that there are good models close by, and I know that we can work together to overcome any obstacles to make sure that this benefits our local economy and our kids.
Thank you, Jim.
I'm not real familiar with this Farm to School programs, but I do think that I do support local control and grassroots control over what happens into our schools, rather than the mandates from the Department of Agriculture or State of Wisconsin. I'm not sure if Wisconsin would divert support from some other program to go to the farm to school programs or not. But I would still need some more information on that, but I think local control is what I would support.
Thank you, Dennis.
I think this is a great program on a number of levels, as Pat said. First of all, we're looking to create jobs in this state, and this is an excellent opportunity to do that. If we produce our food for our children at school locally, farmers will be producing more and more diverse crops to provide to the schools. So they will expand their business. In expanding their business, they will need to hire people. They use equipment on their farms. Someone will need to maintain that equipment. It's just the natural cycle of keeping the economy going, creating jobs, and making our kids healthy is the top priority here, obviously. But there are a number of things here at a number of levels that are nothing but good that I see in this program.
Okay, Elizabeth.
I agree with most of everything that's been said. I think I too was a member of a CSA, and it actually, when I got about the fifth head of cabbage and thought to myself, what tasty treat can I concoct tonight? And actually oven roasted cabbage is not bad. We do need to have healthier food in our schools. My children, we packed lunches for them, or when they got old enough, they packed their own lunches, mostly because my husband is sort of a health nut, nothing but sinew. But one of the things that concerns me is genetically modified foods. And so I think that if we had more action with CSAs and local farmers, we perhaps wouldn't run into as many genetically modified foods as we have now. There are also other things we can do. I know we have a very short growing season here in Wisconsin, but rooftop gardens on some of our schools might be a good idea. There are all kinds of things we can explore with greenhouses that would then combine all kinds of different life lessons or coursework that students can actually have hands-on experience with where food comes from and the science behind agriculture. So I think that we could do a lot better with our schools and the lunches we serve.
It was definitely a good year for kale, Paul.
Yes, it was. Yeah, I like what Elizabeth said. I like what she said in the last answer about the types of foods and how we raise our foods, too. When I was 26, I suffered a stroke, and I'm not a dietitian, but I certainly concentrated a lot more on my diet after I had my stroke. I was in pretty good shape when I had it, but I became very aware of the amount of processed food we eat and how little actual real food we eat, and how little whole grains we eat. So going back just a little bit and talking about the role of government, I find it very beneficial when I'm shopping that I can look for a very visible label saying that this is a whole grain product and that I can feed my kids that whole grain product. I think that's important. But playing off what Elizabeth said, I'm the school board member at a school in Granton, which is a very small town, but we've gone beyond farm to school and we've gone to school to school. I was the chairman of our green team's garden committee. Now, this is not an Agenda 21 thing, but we did have a green team garden committee where we started our own school garden, and it was a full acre garden. Kids were able to plant their own vegetables. They were able to raise their own vegetables. In the fall, they could come out and harvest them, and we had classes that were raising watermelon. They get to eat the watermelon, so they actually they participated in the whole process. I think this is a very good idea, and it's something that some schools in our area, I believe Pittsville already has a grant to do more farm to school types of things. But again, I think we need to get more whole foods in front of our kids, more whole grains, more vegetables, and have them actually take some ownership of raising the vegetables themselves. It's great coursework, by the way.
Thank you. We do have time for one more question on obesity, but I want to remind the audience that following this question and answer, we will have time for your question and answer. So if you're looking to ask a candidate a question, please raise your hand so you can get a card, and then you'll be able to submit that question. So we'll go to the third question.
The rising costs of preventable diseases threaten our health, businesses, communities, and livelihood. Do you think that the state of Wisconsin should create an obesity prevention fund? And if so, how would it be funded?
Let's start with Paul today. This time.
Again, I think you're going to get some hesitancy from people on how we should fund it, but I think it's very clear when you look at all the reports and data that obesity is it's a problem. And we need to do something about it. And I think how we can fund such a program, I think you're seeing more and more public-private partnerships and foundations, fundraising, community-based fundraising to get the word out. I think that's one avenue we can look at. If we find we're making great strides in tobacco prevention, for instance, down the road, possibly we can reallocate some of that money for obesity prevention. But again, I think you're going to get hesitancy from people saying that we need to raise taxes in order to fund an obesity prevention fund.
Thank you. Pat?
Yeah, you're right, Paul. The fact of the matter is I do think that private industry insurance can help motivate the individuals. GreenHeck Fan, they have a new medical staff coming with a gymnasium inside, part of their preventative type of health care, to reach out to get people a little bit more involved on taking care of themselves. I think as well, insurance companies, I have a friend who is called the vegetable box, and he gets a case of vegetables every month, and his insurance company gives him a tax credit for that. So his rates go down. And I think that if insurance said, you know what, if you got your weight down to your normal level, Pat, we would take $100 or $200 off of your money that you pay, your policy. Those type of motivations would hopefully work toward getting us to change our lifestyle a bit. And because when a fund like this comes, how do we tax it? Where do we get the money from? It would have a long discussion, but I do think if we go to the private sector and challenge people to be responsible for themselves, that's the best bet.
Thank you. Mandy?
I agree with my opponent's proposals. I wouldn't actually rule out creating an obesity prevention fund, but I do think we should build on the existing structures that we already have. And the strongest existing structure we already have is our public school system. In this past biennial budget, we did cut $1.6 billion to our public schools. If we want to be innovative, if we want to increase and improve our programming, we need to make sure that our schools have the resources to address anything that comes up, particularly health-wise. With these cuts, we are probably going to be looking at cuts to programs like music and FIED. I'm not sure how we will be able to sustain funding for after-school programming, our sports, and many other things that right now our schools do a lot. On the other hand, according to the information you gave us, childhood obesity rates have tripled over the past 30 years. So just doing things the way we have status quo isn't enough. We need to do more. Healthy minds and healthy bodies go together. As a sixth grade teacher, I have many of those kids for 90 minutes a day. And I know that sitting in a chair for 90 minutes a day simply is not healthy for those kids. I try really hard to find creative ways to have them pass in their papers, or sometimes we get up and do a little yoga break, or sometimes we go for a walk, or just if, you know, there are kids who really cannot sit in a chair for more than 5 minutes, honestly. So I really look for ways to help them be active and yet learning. On the other hand, that's not enough. We need to structure programs so that we are sure that kids are getting the physical activity that they need, the nutrition that they need, and so that we do prevent obesity in a systemic way.
We are approaching the 90-minute mark, and the candidates are doing very well staying in their seats. Thank you. Jim?
Well, for libertarians, the sign of a civilized society is the use of persuasion rather than force. And so I agree with Mandy that the schools should have an important role on teaching healthy lifestyles and healthy eating, and as should, I think, healthy Marathon County organization should be involved with education and persuasion. Rather than have a state program for this, I would prefer that the state stop doing some things like stop banning the sale of raw milk, which is a perfect healthy food, which improves cholesterol levels, enzymes, vitamins and minerals. And in Wisconsin, even though we're the dairy state, the state government prevents small farmers from selling it to consumers who want to purchase it from them right on their farm, just like they do fresh eggs. So I think that that's a crazy law, and it reminds me of the saying from Harry Brown, who was a libertarian presidential candidate a few years ago, that the way government works, they break your legs and then you hand people a crutch and say, see, without me, you wouldn't be able to walk. And the government creates a problem for people, and then we look for a program to fix it. And so I think we need fewer laws in Wisconsin, and I would especially be interested in getting rid of that raw milk ban.
Thank you. Dennis?
Well, I think that a number of things that we've just talked about here while talking about the obesity problem can be carried out and not necessarily at a high cost. We already have physical education in our schools. We already have health classes in our schools. We need to emphasize this problem more. We need to get parents involved. We need to get people in the PTA involved in getting parents out in the community, getting their kids more active, providing more healthy foods for their children. The farm to school program is an excellent way of reinforcing that when the kids come to school. And I know, you know, when kids learn something in school, it's been a while since I still have one at school, I should say. But when they learn something in school, they like to come home and tell everybody about it. And maybe we should be listening to our kids a little bit more and do a little more activity with them. Get out and walk, hike, snowshoe, like I think Mandy does. Get out and do some things, shoot hoops. Like I said, there are a number of things out there that we can do without any funding. But this is definitely something that could be looked at.
Thank you. And finally, Elizabeth.
I think that Mandy's right. We do have a built-in support already for this in our schools, but it depends on having enough funding in our schools to be able to carry these things out, and that's a really important distinction, and I'm glad that you brought that up. Otherwise, I think, you know, our schools, many of them have already taken positive steps. I know that at our high school in Hayward, they finally stopped selling soda and candy bars in the vending machines. Because there were just kids walking around with these giant jugs of Mountain Dew all the time, and that's actually quite harmful. I also think if we want kids to be able to be to play outside and run around and hang out with their friends, we need to have safe neighborhoods. And so a lot of that falls to law enforcement and things like that. And again, if we cut budgets, we don't have the people we need to help people feel safe in their own neighborhoods. So. I think that rather than creating an obesity department, what we can do is focus on things we already have, and instead of cutting funding from these, put funding back into them so that they can do the jobs that they're supposed to do. The other thing that I think Jim said was about, or somebody said, getting parents involved. We put a lot of emphasis on our teachers and on our law enforcement to make sure that our kids are healthy, make sure that our kids learn what they need to do, and I rarely ever hear parents being criticized in this mix. Well, we've got some families out there that are very dysfunctional for many different reasons, but we need to look at the causes of these things, and if it's a home life situation, we need to be able to intervene.
All right, thank you. Well, that concludes the questioner portion of the forum, and now we'll turn to questions from our audience. How are we going to do this? Do we have a microphone, or are we going to bring those questions up? Okay, we're holding. All right, so Melissa and Mandy will be walking around with a microphone, so if maybe you have a question, you might as well go ahead and ask it.
Got a whole bunch of questions here. Hold on a moment. Well, you know what, sir? I'm gonna allow you to ask that first question.
Okay.
And direct it, if you want it directed at a specific person, I invite you to do that. Otherwise, if it's for everybody.
Okay. Actually, I have three questions, but I'll do the first
Start with the first.
And this is for everyone up here, and it has to do, I guess, primarily with alcohol, but a lot of this stuff relates. My question would be, would you vote to repeal the 6 a.m. liquor sales law that was passed during this last legislative session? And a side issue with that is, would you also vote to tighten the DWI to include the laws on snowmobiles as well as watercraft? My first question.
Thank you. Who would like to address that?
The first question was related to the law that passed last year. It was signed in November that allows for Class A establishments, gas stations, grocery stores, and so on, to be able to sell alcohol at 6 in the morning now. Would you vote to repeal that?
Who would like to tackle that?
Well,
okay.
I wouldn't change that law. What was the other part of it?
The other one was about tightening DWI laws to include snowmobiles
and watercraft, to include that in those laws.
Oh, I thought that those were already enforced, included. Do you know that? They patrol for boats and snowmobiles I thought.
Okay, my understanding, and maybe someone else could answer that, is the penalties for someone picked up are not the same as they are if you are picked up DWI with an automobile. That's my understanding.
Do any candidates have a response to that?
Well, I can respond, although my last 9 years were as a detective sergeant, so I wasn't on the road. I don't know exactly how those laws, what the penalties are at this time. But you're right. What I do remember is that they are much less. That is something that should be looked at. We're seeing more people being able to afford boats now and snowmobiles. And especially in this state, alcohol goes along with having fun. As far as the question about the 6 a.m., we just talked about alcoholism in this state and binge drinking. What you have now is you have bars open until 2:30 on the weekends. Then they go to somebody's house. And they drink there till who knows how long. Now the next question is going to be, okay, can we wait till 6 o'clock and we can go get some more? Do we want people who've been drinking all night out on the road when now people are starting to go to work? There are children in the streets. It's daytime. These are all things that we have to examine and think about when looking at something like that. I don't think that I wouldn't have a problem with overturning that. But again, rather than just make a snap decision, there's a lot of thought and research that would have to be put into that. But those are just my thoughts.
Would anyone else like to address that question?
You know, the 6 a.m., there are third shift people that do come off of work and want to be able to purchase some alcohol as well. Also, I think we should have a little bit more responsibility for the clerks. If someone comes in who's inebriated at 6 in the morning and wants to buy alcohol, just refuse it. So if they seem like they're totally drunk. But in the same sense, someone who's getting off of work or maybe heading off to a sporting event for a tailgate, I've seen states like Missouri that didn't even have Sunday liquor sales. And there's ways around that, and they finally repealed that. And as far as the snowmobile and the boating, yeah, I think especially on the financial side, if you put those penalties as high as driving drunk, you still could kill someone and harm property, so I would be for that.
I'd like to weigh in and just say that all my decisions will be made in terms of what's the better good. So 6 a.m. liquor laws, it's hard for me to imagine just why you would absolutely have to buy alcohol at 6 a.m. in the morning. You couldn't at least stock up the night before. same with DWI, snowmobiles and watercraft. Obviously, we want to make these recreational opportunities safe for everyone, and if people are drinking and abusing their vehicles and the system and the trails and the waterways that we all use, that's not in the interest of the greater good.
Okay. Do we have another question?
We do. Unhealthy foods are not always easy to identify. Do you support more user-friendly and honest labeling on food products by standardizing for ease of comparing the same or similar products? I don't know how much comparing you've done, but sometimes it's pretty difficult.
I would like to answer that one. Yes, I think that food does need to be labeled. Again, if you're looking at things like genetically modified foods, we should know what it is we're putting into our systems. We should know for ourselves and we should know for our families. So I fully support labeling all food products for what's actually in them.
Thank you. Okay.
I would definitely support that, and I would take it a step further. I was talking before about some of the labels that appear on like whole grain products. Let's say this is whole grain. Sometimes producers put full labels on there that don't really say whole grain but imply it. And we need to make sure that there's no that there's honesty in advertising as well. But I think that is very key. It certainly helped me become a better consumer at the grocery store. And I think that we probably should look at encouraging that more.
I'd like to concur. I think truth in advertising is very important, and as people are trying to make good, healthy decisions, they need to be empowered with knowledge. So I think absolutely we should be improving our labeling systems. Elizabeth brought up GMOs. I'm also concerned about hormones in our foods. I'm also concerned about where it's produced, because oftentimes we're not aware of where it's coming from. There are many, many issues in terms of our food processes, and I would like to see more transparency in the entire process.
I'm not allowed to go grocery shopping in my house because I don't read any labels. So for my wife's sake, I concur with everybody else, I think.
All right.
May I say one more thing? There's also something else to that would need to be on labeling too, is the amount of medications that are not just pesticides used on fruits and vegetables, but medications that are routinely given to animals. Because those stay in the food chain, and there are reasons why we have antibiotic resistant bacteria out there today. I'm not saying that that's the sole cause of it, but it certainly is something that we need to look at.
Paul? One more thing. We just had this discussion last night at our school board meeting. When I was a kid, which wasn't terribly long ago, but I don't remember a single child in our entire school that had a peanut allergy. And now it seems like every class has at least one or two kids that have a peanut allergy. So I think that there needs to be more research into, like Elizabeth said, genetically modified organisms, genetically modified plants. I find it very suspicious that we have so many peanut allergies popping up, and I'd like to get to the bottom of exactly what is happening.
Jim?
Yeah, well, going back to raw milk, now that you bring that up, if you look at the Amish kids, they don't have very many allergies, if any. And why is that? That I think the pasteurized milk kills a lot of the enzymes and friendly bacteria that helps build a person's immunities. And I think that, if I understand it correctly, that there are raw milk associations which have standards, and they do mark their milk, and they do indicate if it's grass-fed or whatever, and whether the animal has been given antibiotics or medications. They try to avoid it as much as possible for the purity. So labeling like that, I think, is real helpful.
Okay, we'll give Elizabeth the last word here.
Sorry, I'll just make it really quick. I certainly wouldn't do anything at this point I don't know how I would come down on the side of the raw milk issue, but I have seen many cases of Clostridium difficile that came from people drinking raw milk. So to say that it's completely harmless is not necessarily the case. That said, as I said, I don't know where I'd come down on it because I don't know enough about it. All I know is my own experiences in seeing outbreaks of these things and having it be traced back to that.
All right, do we have another question from the audience?
I think you focused quite a bit on some fairly specific public health issues this evening. Maybe if I could ask you to step back a little bit to investment in public health and investment in preventive health. As we move into an accountable care, healthcare delivery system based on results and on evidence, Wisconsin is at the lowest, if not the lowest, investment in public health in the country. Probably 49th or 50th, Joan will tell me. What strategies do you have to strengthen that investment in public health, particularly in the sense of providing better preventive, primary population-based health care. We really are not leading the nation.
Thank you.
Yes, Elizabeth.
I'll go. Actually, Minnesota is doing some really interesting things as far as what they're calling healthcare homes, and they don't, that doesn't necessarily mean somebody's house, but it means that care providers are going to be concentrated so that you go to a facility, and if you need podiatry care because perhaps you have diabetes and there are some foot issues, you get it taken care of there. Electronic health records are supposed to help concentrate all of the information so that people are not repeating expensive tests and things of that nature. So all of these things can help bring down the cost of healthcare, but at the same time, when we're looking at what typical Medicaid reimbursement is in the state of Wisconsin, it's very low historically. And if you're gonna get reimbursed $104 for a colonoscopy that would cost, an insurance company would pay $5,000 for, your hospital's gonna start taking on a lot of debt, and that's not gonna get recovered.
Thank you. Mandy, did I see you?
Yes. Thank you. First of all, I've always said that we need access to quality, affordable healthcare for everyone. I do think it is one of the foundations of having a healthy community, and if we're going to grow jobs and we're going to keep a strong education system and we're going to have healthy communities overall, we need to make sure that people have access to quality, affordable healthcare, particularly prevention. Thank you for bringing up that topic. First of all, I do support the healthcare exchanges that will be implemented by the Affordable Care Act because they are a step in the right direction towards providing quality, affordable care. People will have access to shop for different healthcare options, and I think that's really important, especially people who are already who are falling under the umbrella of lack of services because they are individually employed or work for too small of a business. In addition, I think it's important to support community health programs. We have some excellent community health programs which are already filling the gaps here, particularly the Bridge Community Health Clinic and Family Planning Health Services, among others. I also agree with Elizabeth that we need to make sure that if we are providing public health services, we need to reimburse our providers appropriately so that they have the incentives to continue to provide services for those people. Thank you.
Thank you. Would anyone else like to respond? All right. Do we have any other questions?
Can you all hear me? Okay. I think somebody mentioned before about the OWIs and DWIs in Wisconsin, that here it's more like kind of joining the club. And Wisconsin, along with a handful of other states, actually the first time OWI offense is not a criminal offense, meaning it doesn't go on your criminal record. You basically just get the fine and get your license revoked. I was just wondering from all of you if you would support some type of legislation to make a first offense a criminal offense, or just your thoughts on first-time OWI offenders.
Before we tackle that, I just want to mention that following this question, this will be our last question, we'll have Karen Katz come up, and I just wanted to notify Karen about that. So, yes, go ahead. Who would like to respond?
Well, I can respond to that. I would say the first OWI offense is extremely costly. First in the fines, then in the loss of driving, your auto insurance goes up. And anyone that comes to grips with themselves about that, usually, I think a high percentage, don't have a second offense. Now, the ones that do, second time around, it would be a more serious dilemma. I do have to say with Paul that in Wisconsin, we do seem to have that stigma where if you get an OWI, you're part of the club. Well, not if you talk to the individual and what it's done to the family, especially the ones that have really realized they've hit rock bottom. But when it comes to the fines, the penalties, and things to that nature, I think they're quite substantial for the first offense.
Thank you. Other thoughts, Jim?
I'd just say there's some implications if you, when you put somebody into the legal system and put something on the record, and if it's a repeat offender, There are, the repeat offenders are, I think, are the real problems, not the the first offense problems and the multiple high BAC levels. Those are the people who are causing problems on our highways.
Paul.
And I wouldn't ask Pat to comment on this if it makes him feel awkward, but I think most people, the concept that if you get caught driving drunk your first time, that's your first time driving drunk, I don't think is correct. I think most people that get OWIs probably have driven drunk before, and this is the time that they happen to get caught. So, but as far as criminalizing the first case again, I think that it would be difficult to do politically. But I am a huge proponent of treatment and a huge proponent of education. I had a friend in high school that got an OWI right out of high school, and he went through the treatment process, and at first he just kind of, it was something he had to do, and he came out of that completely changed after learning about actually working with a counselor. He changed how he lived his life completely, and that was a huge benefit to him.
Thank you, Dennis. Oh, and then Mandy after Dennis.
I just want to build on all these ideas. I think we've all put out good ideas, actually. I also think, though, that when it comes to people who are reoffending for the fifth and sixth time, it's important not to recreate the system for the deviants that are most egregious. For most people, it is a deterrent the way that it is right now, but it would be, I think, difficult to recreate the entire system just because we are very concerned about those few people who keep reoffending, and we need to find ways to address the issue of the people who keep reoffending, absolutely, but I also think we maybe need to be a little more creative about that. I think education is a great possibility.
Thank you, Dennis.
I just wanted to say that I believe currently the fifth offense brings a felony charge. Fourth offense brings a felony charge. I think there should be some thought into bringing that down a couple of notches, maybe one or two down in second or third offense. As Pat said, a lot of first-time offenders, and Paul said initially also that most people that are arrested for drunk driving, it's not their first time driving drunk. But I do believe that a lot of people do, from my experience, do learn their lesson after being arrested for the first time drunk driving. But I think we could move that felony offense down from the fourth offense down to third or second, possibly.
Do we have any other thoughts? All right. Well, we'd like to thank you so much, candidates and panelists. And now I'm going to turn the time over to Karen Katz, who's the chair of Healthy Marathon County. Thank you.
Just a few comments. There's a lot of thank yous that should go on for an afternoon like this. We want to thank this facility, obviously. It's been very gracious to host this, and the UW Marathon County, too. We've got the alcohol and other drug partnership. We've got the tobacco free coalition, healthy eating and active lives, a lot of people that are really involved with Healthy Marathon County, and we want to thank them for that, and their constant vigilance at keeping their message loud and clear in our community. A couple of folks here, we've got Chris Berg for technical assistance, and then Chris McCain for organizing the facility and the refreshments outside. Mostly thank you to all of you fine people, first off, for running for office. I remember years ago, that was a big issue in our community to just get people interested in running. So thank you so much, and for having it on your heart to represent people. Thanks for that. Thanks for taking time out of your day and being informed. I think on behalf of Healthy Marathon County, it's exciting to spend 2 hours talking about this stuff. We talk about it a lot, and so we're just thrilled to have people in our audience that are passionate about these topics, and thanks again.